Hi, and good evening, good morning, good whatever. We've watched a movie tonight, and we'd like you to join us in our discussion and listen to what we have to say about it. And what did we watch?
We watched Highlander 2.
From 1991.
Yes. We have previously watched the first Highlander movie together, but that was before we started recording these. But I think the consensus was there that we liked it both of us.
Yes. Oh yeah, definitely.
Maybe not so much this one.
Yeah, let's get into that. But before, a short summary. Oh my god, this is the most horrible part though.
Summary is really difficult.
Oh my god. Okay, we're gonna have to help each other in this, I think.
Yes.
So, in the first one, Highlander,
Connor McLeod
becomes the one. He's been immortal for 400 years, then he kills off the other immortals on the Earth, which he needs to do to become this, the one who gets to be mortal, and also have a lot of wisdom and...
Yeah, knowledge.
Knowledge and whatever. He gets to be normal but wiser than anybody else.
Basically.
So that's where this... that's the premise of the first one, and...
Very shortly described.
Very shortly. So in this one it's in the future, 2024, and we have this huge shield in the sky because of the ozone layer, which has been totally destroyed, and McLeod, with his great wisdom, made the ozone shield happen to save humanity because his wife dies because of the ozone layer. I don't think this is a spoiler. It's pretty obvious that he's alone in the beginning, I don't think I've ruined the movie for you. And then what happens? Well,
but basically the society, civilization under the shield has sort of developed into a dystopia, and it's a pretty shitty place to live, but then you say, well, we can't turn off the shield because the ozone layer, but maybe it turns out that the ozone layer has fixed itself, but the company who owns the shield wants to continue having the shield because it's a monopoly and gets the money and all that.
Exactly.
So that's one thing that's going on in the film.
Then we have this whole other thing where a long time ago there was a battle, and McLeod was in the battle on the good side along with Sean Connery, and they were fighting a dude called Katana. But Katana wins, and he sends McLeod, I always want to say Highlander, but I sends McLeod and Sean Connery to the future.
Yes.
They just say the future.
In this version.
Yes.
In the original American theatrical version, they were actually a different planet rather than the past. But neither of which makes sense. So just
go with it. Don't even start to think about it.
Yeah, pick whichever you like best, I guess.
So anyways, he sends them to the future and they become these immortal people who live on Earth, doomed to fight each other till the end, and by then the one person is free, essentially. Oh my god. So then he discovers that McLeod is still alive, and he wants to kill McLeod, and then the movie happens, basically.
Yes.
Anything more than this is kind of in the spoiler realm. So quickly, would you recommend Highlander 2, or...?
Not really.
No. Yeah.
Not as a sequel to the first Highlander, because it's not a very good sequel. Maybe if you look at it as a standalone film, it can be sort of a stupid but fun sci-fi adventure. But that's the highest praise I would give it. That, you know, it's a little bit of fun, but it's pretty stupid also. So no, not really recommended. It's not the crappiest film I've ever seen, but it's not very good either. It's very confusing and convoluted, and how about you?
Well, I can only agree with you there. I think it's the kind of movie that you can put on and you can do your phone surfing on the internet or whatever you want to call it, and think of other things in the meantime, because if you start to really pay attention and you're like, I'm gonna watch this movie, you're not gonna understand anything. You're gonna be frustrated and you're gonna say, why is this so different from the first one?
Mm-hmm.
In a bad way, because different isn't bad inherently. Different is just another direction, and this one is just, it's a bit confusing. So, to some people I would recommend it, but not generally. Not as a sequel, as you say. So whatever, just agreeing. So, oh my god, where do we even start with this? If you just look at it as a fun standalone movie, what would be the things that you say, well, I like this? Because there's a lot of things that we've been frustrated with during watching it. We discussed a lot of them and we actually stopped the movie a couple of times. To have coffee and ice cream, by the way, not just to understand things, we're not bad. But whatever. So what do you think of the good things? What are the good parts of Highlander 2?
I think the scenery is pretty nice. It's this very dirty dystopia.
Yeah.
I think it looks kind of nice. It doesn't look perfect. I mean, perfect when you're talking about dystopia is a weird expression, but you can kind of tell that they didn't have the largest budget in the world. But I still think it looks kind of nice, and then the lights, the way they use light and shadows, were also kind of nice. And I also kind of like the idea with the ocean shield and all that, but that felt like a completely different movie.
Yeah.
The idea for that I thought was kind of interesting and could have been something, maybe not great, but good, potentially.
Yeah. I kind of feel like that should have been a movie with someone like Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Yeah.
Plus a girl. You know, the way it is.
Yeah.
And the prison break thing and the ocean layer thing. That could have been one thing with someone like Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Sort of like an, I don't know, Escape from New York kind of thing.
Yeah, we're kind of like that vein.
Yeah.
There's just too much going on for it to have any sort of significance. And when the ocean layer is finally, well no, when the shield is finally like dissolved and it's supposed to be this very, you don't, it's hard to care.
Yes.
It's really hard to care.
It's supposed to be a big payoff, but it really isn't.
No.
Because there's been so much else going on in the film.
Exactly. So, should we talk about the wasted potential in this movie?
Louise,
and also Sean Connery, in a way.
Yes. Well, Louise, the first time we see her in the film, she is introduced as this activist, and she's against the shield, you know, she wants it gone. And she kind of breaks into, I think, one of the company headquarters or something, and it turns out that the ocean layer is actually, it's alright, and we can remove the shield, and it would actually be better if we do that. But the company is keeping this secret. And she's introduced very kick-ass woman, you know, she's breaking and entering and all that. Figuring out secrets.
Yeah, she's the leader also. So.
Yeah, exactly. But then during the film, she just turns into this, I don't know, not really damsel in distress, but whenever she hooks up with Connor, both romantically and just as sort of partners in crime, I guess. And it's very weird, and every time there's like a dangerous situation, he just tells her, hide, and then he does all the dangerous things, and it's just so weird, and I'm like, she could have been so kick-ass, but she wasn't.
And it's kind of like the movie didn't know what to do with her after the scene when Connor becomes young again.
Mm-hmm.
After that, she doesn't really have a purpose. I mean, the ozone layer and that whole struggle is her purpose, but she's not really... The way I interpreted things anyways, the way I saw it, she didn't really drive the movie forward because of that, because he was so involved in it to begin with also. So I don't know, she could have just not been there.
Yeah,
it would have made no difference almost. So yeah, that's Louise.
Yeah. And the second wasted potential is Sean Connery.
Yeah,
which he is a good part of the film, you know, whenever he's on screen you're like smiling because it's Sean Connery and he's
very serious. Yeah.
But what did he do in the film, really?
No, he didn't do much. He stopped a propeller from killing them in the prison because they're trapped. And that's basically it.
Yeah, like, he stopped it with like magic and unexplained, confusing way.
Yeah, it was really... No. It's weird because they, I feel like they went through, they cut a few corners in bringing him back. Like, they didn't really care if it didn't make any sense.
Yeah, because he dies in the first film.
Yeah.
Like, it's supposed to be permanently, as far as we know.
Yeah, because dead, he's one of the immortals, so he's, as we know, permanently dead.
It's like, just call out my name,
yeah,
and I will come. And
exactly, and he does so.
Connor calls out Ramirez, and
yeah,
Ramirez turns up.
And it just becomes one more of those things that don't really work. And it's a shame, because I really feel like the parts with Sean Connery are almost the best ones. I do think that Sean Connery is probably the best actor in the movie.
Yes.
He has the most charisma. He also has that, what do you say, like, a glimpse in the eye.
Yeah, I don't know what the expression is.
Well, he has that, I guess. he has well, that sort of roguish and charm to him, which is very nice to see. Like, it's entertaining and charming, and I do feel like the other two main good characters lack that.
Yeah.
What do you think,
yeah,
of Christopher Lambert? Can he is he an actor who can have an entire movie series on his shoulders?
Not really. I wouldn't call Christopher Lambert a bad actor, but he doesn't stand out enough, really, to do what needs to be done in Highlander.
Mm.
Or at least in Highlander 2. I think in Highlander 1 he does a pretty good job, but
yeah,
not in this one. And the same for the actress, for Louise. I don't think she's a bad actress, but, you know, Sean Connery is like, when he's on the screen, you're like, yes, there's something extra here. And I think the others are lacking that,
yeah,
unfortunately.
Yeah, it's almost like you can tell who's a star, almost, and who's not. Oh man, there's so much. Where else should I'd have to go through my notes again.
Well, one thing that was really missing from this film was the music by Queen.
Oh my god, yes.
Because
the music
in the first Highlander movie is so good.
Mm.
So good. And the music in this one is really not that good. We do get an instrumental version of Who Wants to Live Forever, which is from the first film. And we also get a little bit of Queen music, which, ironically, it was New York, New York, which they only, Freddie Mercury didn't want to record that piece, but they sort of forced him to do it for the first film, and he only recorded like 1 minute of it.
Oh.
And it's like, of all the music tracks from the first film you could have picked, you picked
that's
that one.
Interesting.
It's like, I'm like, okay, yeah, sure.
Yeah, the music is just, in general, it's pretty nondescript and muddled, and there isn't any clarity to the sound. It's very,
yeah I think it's supposed to sound like,
I'm sure,
like I don't know, futuristic in a way.
I'm sure it is, but it doesn't work.
No,
especially when you compare it to the first one, which is,
yeah,
way better. Way
and
better.
The music they have in like the action scenes is just so
dull.
Yeah, exactly. Like, it's supposed to be heart pounding and, you know, adrenaline and all that, and it's just like, this music is so uninspiring.
Yeah, I think in general that's what you can sort of take with you when you've watched this movie, that it's sort of uninspiring. You don't feel like you want to watch another one. Maybe you should go into the fact that there's 2-3 different versions. And how they differ, and just like short.
Yeah,
you know.
There's several different versions of this film, but there's like 3 main ones, I guess you could say. There's the original American theatrical version where they come from a different planet. That one you can find on VHS and Laserdisc, I believe. Then there's the original European theatrical version, which I don't believe has been released in any way, in any home video format, which has a different ending. But in that one, they also come from a different planet. And then we have this one, which is the Renegade version, where they have changed a lot of things, and the immortals instead come from far in the past, which I don't know if that works better or not. Neither really works. But this is considered the best version, and I think this is also the longest version. So, I mean, we found this pretty confusing, but the original version was even more confusing, presumably.
Yeah. So maybe, like, we have quite a lot of complaints, to be honest. Like, we complained a lot when we watched this movie.
It was honestly, it was kind of fun to watch it together.
Yeah.
Because it was like, how does this work? And we're like, we don't know.
But yeah, like, watching this with someone is probably the way you want to watch it, to
yes,
be honest.
Yes.
It's sitting here alone, I mean, I'd be on my phone the whole time, just going on Etsy or whatever, just to doing something else. So yeah, we had a lot of fun just like pointing out, whoa, what's going on? What? Where? What? What's happening? Where? Oh, do you think that was like different theories and like how is this working? If someone came to you and said, hey, we want to make Highlander 2.
Yeah.
How would you do it?
Not this way. I would probably make a prequel instead of a sequel. And not have the same characters in the film at all, and sort of explore more where the immortals came from, you know. Were they created by God? Was it cursed by someone? Was it aliens? Whatever, you know, explore that. This one kind of does a little bit, but it's mixed in with three other plots, and it's so confusing.
Yeah.
So I would have just focused on that, and not bothered with bringing back Christopher Lambert or Sean Connery, because those characters are done with.
I agree with you. I think, again, I really like Sean Connery, but I also think that a character needs to die when it needs to die, basically, because otherwise you start to get this, the disbelief starts creeping in, and that's not a good thing. I would have probably explored the whole immortality thing a bit, and I also like the time travel. No, not the time travel, but having one person living through different epochs in history. I think that's interesting. I've always found that interesting. So that's probably how I would do it. But
Have you seen this film? Let us know in the comment section down below what you think of it. Like and subscribe as usual, and we will see you again soon. Bye bye.